Ecclesiastes 12. They told me your theme is living for Jesus 24/7. And that's the only way to live for Jesus, isn't it? Well, they say 99.5 won't do. To serve the Lord Jesus Christ, you've got to serve Him all day, every moment of your life. Ecclesiastes 12, I'm reading from the New American Standard Bible. I just want to read verse 1 to you. It was read earlier. I see some people are still turning. Ecclesiastes 12, verse 1. It says, "Remember also your Creator in the days of your youth, before the evil days come and the years draw near when you will say, 'I have no delight in them.'" Let us pray. Father, I thank you. You are awesome in so many ways. Father, I am humbled by this opportunity, yet I am excited because your word is true. Lord, help me to preach with conviction and help me, Lord, to preach with power. Help me, Lord, to decrease so that Christ might increase. These are your people, Lord, this is your word. This is your time. All this we ask in Jesus' name, amen. I decided to give a subject for the sermon today is give God your best while you still have your best to give. Give God your best, young people. Give God your best while you still have your best to give. Youth and being young is synonymous with vitality. Your minds are fresh. You're capable of learning new things. Your bodies can do things that people my age and older wish we could do. You know, your skin is still tight. Things are still in place. You know, I knew when I was getting old when I couldn't understand rap lyrics anymore. I love rap. The W-O-R-D is the B-I-B-L-E. I like that. I like that. I understood that because it was about the word. But I remember this group, what was it, Dos Effects came out? I don't know if y'all remember that, Young Effects. Bum, stiggity, bum, hup. You know, I got the rope of dope styles. I was like, what? What's he talking about? I kind of lost touch with rap after that. But young people, you all have what a lot of people want. You've got your youth. You've got your whole lives virtually ahead of you. Spanish explorer, what was it, Ponce de Leon, tried to find the fountain of youth so that people could live forever. People pay big money, young people, to look young again. Anybody watch that show, Nip and Tuck? Y'all know you watch that show. Young people, you've got something very valuable that you possess, and it's something that you can use to glorify God. I want to encourage you today, young people, wherever you are, if you think you're young or if you're young, I want to encourage you to give God your best while you still have your best to give. The writer of this passage is believed to be Solomon. He says, "Remember your Creator in the days of your youth before the evil days come and the years draw near when you say, 'I have no delight in them.'" The New Living Translation reads like this: "Don't let the excitement of youth cause you to forget your Creator. Honor Him in your youth before you grow old and no longer enjoy living." You see, what happens to a lot of people, some of you may be here today, you wasted all your good years out in the world. Partying, drinking, smoking. Y'all know Rick James, 52, died of natural causes. He partied his life away. A lot of us party our lives away. When we get tired, nobody wants you anymore. Things don't look like they used to look on you. You're used up, broke. Then we come to the church and say, "Lord, I'm sorry for what I've done. I want to give my life to you." And the Lord will take you. The Lord can use whoever, right? But young people, I want to encourage you, don't wait till you're busted, broke, used up, nobody wants you before you come to God. Bring God your best while you're young, while your mind is fresh. Because what happens is, if you wait, you'll end up living a life full of regrets. Some of us adults, we got some regrets in here, don't we? huh? People we used to know and hung out with, and places we used to go, we wish we never went, and decisions we made, we wish we never made. And so I think the author here, Solomon, is writing this passage out of probably a life of regrets, things that he wish he had not done. But young people, you have an opportunity. Your slate is clean in a sense. You haven't had a long enough life to do a lot of bad things. You don't have to do everything. Amen? Don't wait till the end of your life to come to the Lord. Solomon goes into some good analogies of what it's like growing old. He talks about, in verse 2, the sun and the light and the moon and the stars are darkened. He's talking about your eyes. You can't see so well anymore. He talks about the day that the watchmen of the house tremble. He's talking about your legs and your bones get weak, the trembling. Young people, you have energy. Use that energy for the Lord. You ought to be evangelizing. You ought to be in Bible study. You ought to be going to seminaries and Bible colleges. Give God your life while you're young. Let me move on. You know, everybody has regrets. That's why I don't understand why people think Christians are perfect, because Christians are actually the ones who know we're not perfect. And we seek the perfect one, Jesus Christ, because he is the propitiation, that's the replacement, of our sins. He who knew no sin became sin for us. So we're not perfect. We know we're sinners. And we come to a Savior to save us. Don't live a life of regrets, wishing you could have done this and that. Let me move on, because I know you all have to go to Paris this afternoon. So what is it? I wonder what happened to Solomon that caused him to write this passage of regret like this, not to waste. It's an admonition to young people. I think if Solomon were here today, he'd probably read that verse to you. So I'm going to stand in Solomon's shoes, in the shoes of the Ecclesiastes, the preacher, and tell you today to give God your best while you still have a chance. Let's take some snapshots of Solomon's life. If you have your Bibles, turn back to 2 Chronicles chapter 1. I'm going to keep going for sake of time, but you all can catch up with me or write it down, or, as Cynthia said, get the tape. Now, 2 Chronicles chapter 1, we see that Solomon had a heart turned toward God early on in his kingship. Solomon was the son of David, the greatest king in Israel's history. It says, now Solomon, the son of David, established himself securely over his kingdom, and the Lord his God was with him and exalted him greatly. He learned from his father how to worship the Lord, and the Lord responded and gave him a great kingdom. Verse 6, in the same chapter, Solomon went up therefore before the Lord to the bronze altar, which was at the tent of meeting, and offered 1,000 burnt offerings on it. In that night, God appeared to Solomon and said to him, ask what I shall give you. In verse 6, Solomon knew where he was supposed to be. He was at the temple offering up sacrifices to the Lord. He was worshiping the Lord. Young people, you're singing up here. That's awesome. Praise the Lord with your voice. Praise the Lord with your mind. Praise the Lord in the dance. Praise the Lord in the rap. Praise the Lord in the classroom. Praise the Lord in your home by doing your chores. Whatever you do, praise the Lord. Because when you praise the Lord, look what happens. God responds. God asked Solomon, I've heard your prayers. What do you want? God asked him, what do you want? Now, if God asked you today, what do you want? I'd like a $500,000 house. You know, like the one, I don't like. I want a house like Shaq. That's what I want. I'd like some new shoes, some clothes. No. Solomon didn't ask for any of those things. Look what Solomon responded with in verse 9. Now, O Lord God, your promise to my father David is fulfilled, and you have made me king over a people as numerous as the dust of the earth. Give me now wisdom and knowledge. Wisdom and knowledge. Priceless. He wasn't looking for dollars. He wasn't looking for riches. He said, give me wisdom and knowledge so that I may guide your people.